Welcome to the tutorial for the Jupiter's Moons Lab. In this lab, we're finding the mass of the planet Jupiter from the orbits of several of its moons. This is a specific example of one of the most widely used types of measurement in astronomy, looking at the orbits of bodies to find the masses of the things they orbit. The reason this works is because gravity depends on mass, and gravity is also what determines orbits. But the key is that orbits really just depend on the gravity of the bigger body, unless both are almost the same mass. So in most cases, we can simply ignore the mass of the smaller body that's doing the orbiting. Note that this tutorial is not intended as a substitute for reading through the lab write-up. I'm not going to go over every step in the lab. Instead, I'm going to focus on just two parts that often trip people up. The first is the Jupiter Moon Tracker, a unique kind of diagram we can use to measure the motions of Jupiter's moons. The second is the table we fill in to let us calculate the mass of Jupiter. The story of our study of Jupiter's moons starts back in 1610, when Galileo Galilei pointed an early telescope at Jupiter. He immediately noticed that on either side of the planet, there were a few bright stars in a line. At first, he thought that was just an interesting coincidence, but after going back and observing, he kept noticing three or four of these stars lined up around the planet. Eventually, Galileo realized that these stars were really moons orbiting around Jupiter in much the same way that the Earth's moon orbits around the Earth. This was a very important discovery in the history of astronomy, and it helped make the case for the idea that the Earth was not the center of the universe, but instead just another planet orbiting the Sun. However, in this lab, we're going to focus on how we can use observations like Galileo's to track the motions of those moons. Let's have another look at that page of observations from Galileo's notebook. What Galileo did here is draw pictures of Jupiter and its moons night after night on the same page. As you follow down the page, you're seeing Jupiter's moons move around the planet over time. Imagine we took a bunch of observations like the ones in these drawings, but made sure we did them every night. If you look at the dates, you'll see that Galileo missed a few nights. Also, let's line up the diagrams so that Jupiter is always in the same place in the middle of the diagram. Finally, let's add something that would have been a little tricky for Galileo. Labels for each of the moons so that we know which one is which. In that case, we get a picture like the one on the right. Now, since we know which moon is which, we can start connecting the dots for each moon. Let's start with Callisto, the outermost moon and the one that moves the slowest. In the time shown here, it looks like Callisto makes about one half of an orbit around Jupiter. Next, we'll add Ganymede, which orbits a little faster and closer to Jupiter. After that, we'll do Europa. Finally, let's put in Io. Io orbits fast enough that we might not be getting quite enough points to really see the shape of its orbit well. But look what we've got. A diagram showing the motions of the moons around Jupiter over the course of a little more than a week. This is an example of a Jupiter Moon Tracker diagram. Here is the Jupiter Moon Tracker diagram from your lab. You'll be asked to measure two things about each moon's orbit. First, you should find the period of the orbit. That's just the time it takes a moon to go around Jupiter once. The easiest way to measure that is just to look for when a moon is at its extreme distance from Jupiter on one side of the planet or the other. Then look at the number of days until the next time it is furthest on that same side. Notice the dates on the vertical scale are successive midnights. Count the days, not just the number of midnights. You should record this number as accurately as possible, to the nearest half day at least. Next, find the amplitude of the orbit. This is really the distance from the center of Jupiter to the most extreme point in the moon's orbit. You need to measure it in units of Jupiter radii, which are the units on the scale at the bottom. You can use a ruler or a straight piece of paper to line up the edge of a moon's orbit with the scale to estimate how many Jupiter radii out the orbit is. Repeat both of these measurements for all four moons. You should record your measurements in the Jupiter Moons table. The orbit period goes in column 2, and the amplitude goes into column 4. The next step will be to convert your measurements into units that make it easy to find the mass of Jupiter. To do this, we need to convert the period of the orbit into years. Here's the unit conversion formula we use to do that. Put the answer into column 3. Next, we convert the amplitude into astronomical units, or AUs. This is the formula that lets us do that. When you've done that conversion, put the result into column 5. The reason for doing these unit conversions is it lets us simplify Newton's version of Kepler's third law, the formula that lets us find the mass of Jupiter. In the online lectures, you'll see this formula with the gravitational constant and a few other numbers thrown in. But in the units we're using here, we can eliminate those extra bits and just use the numbers we've calculated. So make sure you use the values you got from the unit conversions in columns 3 and 5 when you do this calculation. This gives you the mass of Jupiter in solar masses, effectively the fraction of the Sun's mass that is Jupiter. We know that Jupiter orbits the Sun, not the other way around, so this value should be less than 1. To get this number into kilograms, just use this unit conversion in which we multiply by the mass of the Sun. Put that answer into column 7. And that's the central part of the lab. There are some other exercises to do, so make sure you read through the whole lab and finish all of the parts.